بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله النبي الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، firstly, a sincere apology on my behalf for being late. There was an accident on the way, out of my control, but خير إن شاء الله. We have a little bit to cover which we didn't speak about last time. I wanted to give a recap and then go over these other things. I just wanted to ask you brothers for your permission if I go sort of 10 minutes over, is that okay? Okay, inshallah. Okay, I'm just going to firstly just recap on a few things that we spoke about last time we were here, and something that I forgot to mention or I overlooked. I want to mention some key etiquettes of seeking this knowledge about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first thing is that we have to be sincere. So when we're seeking this knowledge, let's be sincere, and we're doing it for no worldly benefit, only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this is of the highest branches of seeking knowledge. We're seeking the knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, jalla wa ala. So it's of the highest branches of seeking knowledge. So let's really harvest the reward, inshallah, yawm al-qiyamah, by being sincere today. The second point is that we need to be patient. I might mention a few things today, it might not click straight away, but be patient, inshallah. For future sessions, it might be worthwhile if you just bring a pen or you try and note something down. It always helps to make it easier to remember. The third thing is that when we are seeking this knowledge, we should ensure that our company is good. Because the Prophet alayhi salam said that a man is on the deen of his companion. So if you leave here today having, you know, sought this knowledge, and then you go back and you hang around and you mix with people who are bad, this knowledge is going to leave you very, very quickly. So it's very, very important that you keep with good people, with good company. We have to persevere. So we have to have perseverance, because the path to knowledge, it won't always be easy, but we always have to continue to strive. We can't be arrogant. As much as we think we know, there's always somebody who knows more. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you have been given of knowledge, but a little. So even the most knowledgeable amongst us possesses a very small amount of knowledge. So let's not become arrogant and think we know everything. We shouldn't speak in this field without knowledge. So unless you have a text or clear knowledge from the sunnah or clear knowledge of the statements of the scholars, then if somebody asks you something, just say, I don't know, because we are talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself here. Okay, to recap, Ikhwani, we mentioned the term salaf. What does this term salaf means? And we said that it comes from the verb salafa, which means those who have gone before or to go before. And when we're talking about our aqidah, what it means is we follow the way of those righteous predecessors. So we take our understanding from the companions, the prophets of the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, and those early generations of Muslims. We spoke about the station of the companions, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions them, praises them, gives them the seal of approval in the Quran, and says radiyallahu anhum wa radu an, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them and they are pleased with him. So this is why we take their understanding and their path to the religion and no one else's, because theirs is the only path that will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We spoke about the definition of tawheed. It means to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one without any partners or any associate in his lordship, in his names and in his attributes, and in his worship subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in another way, Ikhwani, we can simply say we must realize and maintain the oneness of Allah throughout our lives. So realize the oneness of Allah, maintain the oneness of Allah in everything that we do, all of our thoughts, a very simple definition of Tawheed. And actually, when you think about it, this way, anything that you're going to do, am I maintaining the oneness of Allah in this action? It gives us a life plan as Muslims. Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create the jinn and mankind except to worship me alone. This is our purpose in this life. Why are we on this earth? To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to seek his pleasure, to worship him as he deserves to be worshipped, to ask and to seek refuge in him from his punishment, and to seek his mercy and his reward subhanahu wa ta'ala. We mentioned the situation, how did this science of Tawheed develop? How did this science of Tawheed develop? Did the companions of the Prophet alayhi salam break down tawheed into certain categories? The answer is no. And the reason why we mention, they were taught directly from the Prophet alayhi salam. There was no need for them to break tawheed down into categories. And we emphasized heavily, just because we say tawheed has three categories or two categories, doesn't mean there are two separate gods. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. We only do it to aid our understanding. We said that after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Islam began to spread far and wide. So we had new beliefs, people from all these, Hinduism, Buddhism, Sikhism, whatever it might, not Sikhism, Hinduism and Buddhism, Judaism, Christianity, they were being, you know, incorporated into the Muslim lands. So they brought with them some of their deviant ideologies. And so the scholars, what they began to do was they began to complain to the rulers of the Muslims, and the rulers of the Muslims, they would take care of these issues. At the beginning, this was the case. But then subhanAllah, we had this Christian revert by the name of Sausin, and he went astray in Qadr. He went astray in divine will and predestination. And eventually, subhanAllah, it led them to say, you know, if we say that Allah exists, we've compared him to mankind. So they actually said, Allah cannot exist. And of course, this is just like atheism. And he left the religion. His main student, Ma'bad ibn Khalid al-Juhani, he was the one who continued with this false dawah. He was executed approximately 50 to 60 years after the death of Ali radiallahu anh. And then, subhanAllah, what we found is that the Muslim rulers under the Umayyad Caliphate, we found that subhanAllah, they focus more on the dunya, they lost contact with the scholars of Islam, and so the link was broken and the pure teachings, pure monotheism of Islam was no longer being protected. So these deviant ideas, they spread. So the scholars took it upon themselves to then develop clear sciences so that these false ideologies could be refuted. Okay, Ikhwani, we mentioned how roughly, the scholars broke it into three parts. Some people say two parts, but we'll stick with three parts, inshallah. It'll make it easier for us to understand. The first category of tawheed was tawheed al-rububiyyah, the tawheed of the oneness of lordship, the oneness of the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this basically means that we believe Allah is one. Firstly, we recognize Allah is one without any partner, and that He is alone and unique with regards to His actions, such as creation, such as, you know, controlling the affairs of the universe, giving life and death and so on. So only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who decides what happens and gives life, etc. in this universe. Then we have the tawheed of al-asma wa sifat, the perfect names and attributes of Allah. So we affirm the names and attributes, and we believe that laysa kamithlihi shay', there is nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third category is tawheed al-uluhiyyah or tawheed al-ibadah, the oneness of the worship of Allah. So because Allah is one and He creates and He gives life and He gives death and He decides the affairs of the universe, because there is nothing like Him, then we have to worship Allah. All of our worship is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Ikhwani, I want to bring you some proofs from the Quran for tawheed al-rububiyyah. So if somebody was to say, you know, this tawheed al-rububiyyah, you say Allah is the one who creates and owns and disposes the affairs of the universe, bring your proof from the Quran. So let's have a look at the first thing. In terms of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah jalla wa ala says in Surah Al-A'raf, the 54th ayah, أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ تَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says, unquestionably, His is the creation and His is the command. Blessed is Allah, Lord of all of the worlds. So we have this first proof, that creation is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Creation is only for Allah, and none other than Allah creates. Then, what about ownership? What about the ownership? How do we prove from the Quran that the ownership, the ultimate ownership, is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah says in Surah Al-Jathiyah, the 45th surah of the Quran, the 27th ayah, Allah says, وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And to Allah belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. So now we've established two things. Allah is alone in His creation. He is the only one that creates. Allah owns everything in this universe. And then we have the disposition of affairs. Again, we can use the same ayah, أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ. For Allah is the creation and the command. So only Allah commands what happens in this world, ikhwani. What about some other ayahs? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمْ خَالِقُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُ فَأَنَّا تُؤْفَكُونَ. That is Allah, your Lord, the creator of all things. There is no deity, there is no God worthy of worship except Him. So how are you deluded? How are you deluded? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ اللَّهُ الْخَالِقُ الْبَارِئُ الْمُصَوِّرُ لَحُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. This is in Surah Al-Hashr. He is Allah, the creator, the inventor, the fashioner. To Him belong the best names. Okay, ikhwani, now if somebody was to bring to you an ayah of the Quran, an ayah which is in Surah Al-Mu'minun, and he was to say, hang on a minute, you Muslims have it confused because you claim that there's only one God. You claim there's only one God, but then your own Quran, in the Quran Allah says, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. So blessed is Allah, the best of creators, in a plural way. How would we respond to this? How would we respond to this ayah in the Quran where Allah says, the best of creators? How would we respond to the hadith which is in Bukhari and in Muslim, where those people who create images, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells them, says that on Yawm al-Qiyamah they will be told, give life to what you have created. Give life to what you have created. So we might have some doubts now. How do we respond to this? Isn't there a contradiction? Ikhwani, in actual fact, there's no contradiction. Because creation means bringing something into existence. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply says, kun fayakun. He says, be and it is. So from nothing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth. And this is specific for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he says that the word creation in this context is used for others, but in actual fact, it means changing the form. So let me give you an example. We say that the carpenter created the door. But did the carpenter create the tree? Does that make sense? So the carpenter, it said in speech, the carpenter created the door, or he fashioned the door. But in reality, he never created the door. He just changed its form. Is everyone following? It's a concept which you need to be able to understand. So although it's called creation, it's not actually creation, it's changing the form. And it's not, he can't give life, he can't change the door back into the tree. Do we understand that, inshallah? Okay. And it's also a way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disgracing the idols which are being worshipped besides Him. And in reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts it in a beautiful, beautiful form when He says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ ضُرِبَ مَثَلٌ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدَعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا ذُبَابًا وَلَا وِجَتَمَعُوا لَهُ وَإِنْ يَسْلُبْهُمُ الذُّبَابُ شَيْئًا لَا يَسْتَنْقِذُ مِنْهُ ضَعُفَ الطَّالِبُ وَالْمَطُلُوبُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O people, an example is presented for you. This is in Surah Al-Hajj. So listen to it. Allah says, an example is presented to you, so listen. Indeed, those who you call besides Allah will never create even a fly, even if they gathered together for that purpose. Subhanallah. So Allah is telling us here, O you people, everything that you worship except for Allah, if it all came together, all of these idols and gods, they wouldn't be able to create something as simple as a fly. And then Allah says, and if the fly should steal something away from them, they could not recover it from him. And then Allah says, weak are the pursuer and the pursued. Weak is the one who does the worshipping, and the one who is worshipped is also weak. How do we expand on this? Allah says, if the fly should steal away from them something small, they would not be able to recover it from him. I want you to imagine we have the most powerful king in the world, and a fly lands on his perfume or his food, and it takes some of his food. Would that king, despite his armies and his power and his wealth, would he be able to get his perfume back from that fly? Of course he wouldn't. Would he be able to recover his food from the mouth of that fly? Of course he wouldn't. So Allah says, this is how weak they are. Okay, Ikhwani, although in the Quran and the Sunnah there are references directly to Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses it as a stepping stone to Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Because even the pagans, even the Quraysh, the non-Muslim Quraysh, they did not deny the existence of Allah. They did not deny the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they committed shirk. They associated partners with Allah in His Lordship by saying, you know, the creation is for some of these gods. This God can do this and He creates this, and this God sends down the wind, and this God sends down the rain, etc. So this is how they committed shirk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Az-Zumar, the 38th ayah, and if you ask them, who created the heavens and the earth? They would surely say Allah. So subhanallah, even though they are committing shirk, when you ask them who created the heavens and the earth, the Quraysh, they would say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because they committed shirk with worshipping Him and they associated others in worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. He is the one who created you. He is the one who disposes of your affairs. He is the only one that can benefit or harm you. So, and there is nothing like Him. So why are you worshipping others alongside with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this tawheed as a stepping stone to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Likewise, in Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you ask them, who created the heavens and the earth and subjected or subjugated the sun and the moon, they would surely say Allah. They would surely say Allah. Then how are they deluded? Allah extends the provision for whom He wills of His servants, and He restricts it for whom He wills. Indeed, Allah is of all things knowing. And then Allah says, and if you ask them, who sends down the rain from the sky and gives life to the dead earth thereby? They would surely say, Allah. So then Allah says, praise be to Allah, but most of them do not reason. Subhanallah. This is a simple thing. It's like their reasoning has left them. Allah is the one who benefits you with all of these things. And yet you are associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ikhwani, actually, all of the messengers were sent with one message. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. And we certainly sent to every single nation a messenger saying, worship Allah and avoid taghut. Avoid anything that is worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was the message, this was the mission of those messengers. So Ikhwani, I want to give a practical example or something that we can really take away inshaAllah, implement into our daily lives, a practical expression of recognizing Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. And one practical expression of recognizing that Allah is the disposer of my affairs. Allah is the one who created me. Allah is the one who sustains me. Allah owns everything in the heavens and the earth. Ikhwani, it's the beautiful, beautiful thing of patience. Having patience is a wonderful expression of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. How is that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَلِلْرَسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ. O you who have believed, respond to Allah and the Messenger when He calls you to that which gives you life. So Ikhwani, what we know from this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram, anything that Allah has obligated upon us, it's for our own benefit. It's for our own benefit. So we know that Allah wants good for us by sending down this Quran, by sending the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبَلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Do the people think that they will be left to say, we believe, and then they will not be tested? Allah says, but we have certainly tried those before them, and Allah will surely make evident those who are truthful, and He will make evident those who are lying. So Ikhwani, anything that comes in your life, anything that comes in your life, any test, any trial, any tribulation, be patient, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing you in order to raise your rank in Jannah. You know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the disposer of my affairs. So you're going to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. You know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls the affairs of the universe. Nobody can benefit you except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then we should turn directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah tells us, and if Allah should touch you with adversity, then there is nothing or no one to remove it except for Him. And if He touches you with good, then He is over all things competent and able. And then we have the hadith, the beautiful hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, if the whole ummah, if the whole nation were to unite and try and benefit you in something, they would never benefit you except by that which Allah has already written for you. And if the whole ummah was to unite and try and harm you in something, they would never be able to harm you except with that which Allah has already written for you. Ikhwani, this is a beautiful, beautiful thing which allows you to put your trust completely in Allah. If the whole world wanted to harm me, but Allah wanted benefit, Allah wanted good for me, they wouldn't be able to harm me. If the whole world wanted to benefit me, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted something or some harm to fall upon me, nobody would be able to help me. And so this causes us as Muslims to put our full trust and reliance and tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then this leads us on to the next hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, how wonderful is the case of a believer. How wonderful is the case of a believer. There is good for him in everything. And this is not the case except for the believer. So there is good for him in everything. And this is only for the Muslim. If some prosperity comes to him, he expresses gratitude and he is thankful to Allah, and this is good for him. And if some difficulty or adversity falls upon him, he endures it patiently, and that is better for him. Subhanallah. So because you know that I can only turn to Allah, it doesn't matter. Whatever falls in your life, whatever happens in your life, remain patient, and this is better for you. And Ikhwani, I just want to mention Tawiz here. Uqba radiallahu anhu, he reported that a group of 10 men came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to give him the pledge of allegiance. And he accepted it from 9 men, but he didn't accept it from one of the men. And this was because he was wearing an amulet. So the man took it off and broke it. And then the Prophet alayhi salam accepted his oath of allegiance. And then he said, whoever wears an amulet has committed shirk. I want to just break it down. We're not talking about the words of kufr or anything like this. I want to break it down in terms of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. How does this go against the oneness of Allah in this particular category? Because the man thinks that by wearing it, whatever harm was going to come to him, now it's not going to come to him. So he thinks that this Tawheed has the ability to dispose or change his affairs. And this is one of the ways which it goes against Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. So in conclusion, my dear brothers and sisters, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the oneness of Allah in His creation, in His lordship, in His ownership and disposition of affairs. It is mentioned in the Quran, but then Allah says, so worship Him alone. So it's like used as a stepping stone. Because Allah is one. Because He created, He sustains. He's the only one that can change you or help your affairs. Worship Him alone. And it's the fitrah of every single person. It's the fitrah of every single person to be a Muslim, to have this belief in Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Kullu mauludin yuladu ala al-fitrah." Every newborn, every child is born on the fitrah. But then it's his parents who turn him into a Jew or a Christian or a Magian, etc. And actually, we've got a covenant with Allah, as Allah tells us in Surah Al-A'raf. And mention when your Lord took from the children of Adam, from their loins, their descendants, and made them testify against themselves, saying to them, am I not your Lord? قَالُوا بَلَى شَهِدَنَا. And they said, yes, we have testified. And Allah says, this is in case you should say on the day of resurrection, we were unaware of this. So Ikhwani, every single one of us, everyone from Adam alayhi salam to the last man, born before Yawm al-Qiyamah, Ikhwani, every single one of us, be he a Jew, a Christian, whatever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already taken this covenant where He made us testify against ourselves, am I not your Lord? And this is why you find when you speak to a revert, subhanallah, When you say to them, you know, when you took that shahada, when you entered into Islam, what was it like? And they say, my heart changed. My heart changed. I felt a massive weight lifted off my shoulders. Why? Because they are coming back to their natural fitrah, their natural state in which Allah created them, which they deviated from. When they accepted Islam, they came back to that and they feel that their life has completely changed. So Ikhwani, it's a big topic, but my 10 minutes is up. So inshallah, next week or the next time we meet inshallah, I'm going to mention Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat. Again, look at it very, passing inshallah, not too deep. But I hope that this has been of some benefit. If we take nothing away from today, then the key thing is that we remember, nobody can benefit me except for Allah. Nobody can change my affairs except for Allah. Nobody can harm me except with what Allah has already written for me. Nobody can benefit me except with what Allah has already written for me. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one and He owns everything and He created me and He disposes, He decides of the affairs of the universe, I have to worship Him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.